get up those stairs one of these times. Go one more crack at it. I noticed something this morning. I have time to digress. I have an extra 30 seconds. I've gotten very attached to this side of the pulpit. I don't know what there is, but it's become a very nice thing to hold on to. I don't know what I'm going to do somewhere where I don't have that anymore. Pastor had been invited to dinner at the home of the parishioner. It had been a very pleasant evening, but as he was getting ready to leave, the young son of the family came up to say goodbye to him, and the little boy shook hands with the pastor in a very adult fashion and said with a serious expression on his face, "I'm really glad you came, and I just wanted you to know that when I grow up, I'm going to get a really, really good job, and I'm going to make lots and lots of money, and I'm going to send some of it to you." The pastor, thinking there was some great mission adventure in the offing, said, "Thank you, but why would you do that?" And the little boy replied, "Because I just heard my daddy tell my mommy that you're one of the poorest preachers we've ever had." Sometimes other people's words, and even our own words, can come back to haunt us and get us in trouble. Words have power. We can forget that sometimes, but words have power. Power to heal, the power to work, hurt. But the fact is that we want the words that we use to communicate to have substance, to have meaning, to have clarity, to have truth. We've spent the last month or so, 4 or 5 weeks, talking a lot about words. And we've been talking about them individually. Words like trust, grace, faith, piety, service, vision. And we're going to keep doing that for another week or two. Because there have always been problems with communication. It's not something new. As a part of creation, and we'll talk a little bit more about that next week, God gave to us the ability to form and to use words to communicate with Him and with one another. But one of the things we lost in Eden as a result of rebellion against God was the absolute trustworthiness of language. Genesis tells us that because of sin, men and women began to become afraid, began to hide from God and from one another. The little boy was given his grandfather's Bible when he started first grade. He was flipping through the pages and found a dried leaf pressed there from some long before fall. And he cried out, "Mom, I think I just found Adam's suit right here in Genesis." Truth is that from earliest times, we've been trying to hide. Adam and Eve hid in the garden. And we try to hide from God and from one another, not just with fig leaves, but often behind our own words. The people of faith, Scripture, people of earth, Scripture tells us, aspired to build a tower to the heavens, to get closer to God, to become more divine themselves. It was the same thing Adam and Eve were trying to do through a bite from that piece of forbidden fruit. But God saw what they were doing, and more than that, He understood what they were trying to accomplish, and He intervened. And as a result of that intervention, people wound up with a confusion of languages, Scripture says, making them unable to communicate with one another, so that they had to abandon their task. I often have to deal with a confusion of tongues in my own life. I use a Mac. I'm a Mac person. I use Microsoft Word. I use the word use advisedly. I think more often the machine uses me than I use it. But one of the things that frustrates me about my computer and my word processing program is this insatiable desire the machine seems to have to correct me. I mean, and it doesn't just correct my spelling, it doesn't just correct my grammar. It decides that what I have typed on the page is not what I meant to say. The words are wrong. And so it will usually wind up saying, sorry, and change the words around. Actually, it doesn't say sorry. I'm trying to make nice to the computer. And sometimes the word it picks to replace the word I actually use has absolutely nothing to do with what I was trying to say in the first place. Communication is a tough business at best. And it's not just that some people may attempt to use words to deceive. It can simply be that we may not speak the same language. I can remember when bad used to be something that was not good. And then in some parts of the country, bad became something that was good. And then bad became something that was very, very good. Then bad went back to being bad again, at least in some places and at some times. Except that at other times, bad was something that some people considered to be good, and by then I had a headache and gave up on the process. The fact is that words don't just complicate lives, they influence behavior. Now, all this should give us a certain amount of concern, because so much of what we as Christians are called by God to do involves words. Financiers have money, physicians have medicines, farmers have seed and soil, soldiers have weapons, Christians, pastors especially, have words. All kinds of words, worship words, prayer words, preaching words, prophetic words, words of institution for funerals and weddings and communion services, words of baptism, words of witness, words of hope, words of praise, words of comfort, words of challenge, words of love. And that's why it is so important to hear in the gospel that in Jesus Christ, the one who is indeed the Word made flesh, we have been helped to find our way through the confusion of tongues. He has helped us to get our trust in words back, at least in the Word of life that is our Lord and Savior. In our relationship with Him, our words can once again be filled with grace and truth and viewed as instruments of redemption. That's a part of what the story of Jesus and the woman at the well is all about. Jesus didn't heal this woman of any disease. He did not raise a child from the dead. He did not even dazzle her by turning the water she came to draw into wine. He just talked to her. It began as a simple, humble conversation over a drink of water. That's all it started out to be, but it became such more. So much more, because the words he shared with her were so very different, different from all the words she had heard in her life. And because of hearing those words, making them a part of her life, she was never the same again. John's story, by implication at least, doesn't begin with words, however, but with silence, not the soft, comforting silence we all need to experience from time to time, but the cold silence of prejudice. Jesus had come to sit at the well, and the woman had come to draw water. She was a Samaritan, not a pure child of Israel, if you will. And he was a Jew. She was a woman. He was a man who was not her husband or her child. And between a Samaritan woman and a Jewish man, there was a wall of silence that had been built brick by brick with prejudice and hostility over the years. And the hard fact was that not a word was supposed to penetrate through it. And so I suspect they sat in their silence for a minute or two. They're alone because she had come to draw water at a time when she knew no one else would be there. The disciples had gone off searching for food. But finally, this Jewish man broke the silence and simply said, "Would you give me a drink of water?" And with those words, that wall began to crumble just a bit. A very simple, ordinary request, but one which cut against the grain of the culture at the time. It's amazing sometimes how significant words can be. It was in Montgomery, Alabama, on a day in December of 1955, and a bus driver ordered four African-American women to move from the seats in which they were sitting to the back of the bus. And a woman named Rosa Parks simply said, "No." And a wall began to crumble. It was hard for that wall to come down, and it really hasn't completely made it yet today. But the task began with one simple word. Sometimes the simplest words can have the greatest power. Sometimes it doesn't even take a word. I heard once about a preaching class where the instructor wanted to demonstrate different ways to make a point during a sermon. As he stood behind the pulpit, he picked up a bowling ball and held it out in his hand and said, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me." And at that moment, he dropped the bowling ball. And in the aftermath of the crash of it hitting the floor and the stunned reaction to the noise by the class, he said simply, "Never forget, words can hurt." It must have been an effective demonstration because I've always remembered it. But here Jesus simply said, "Can I have a drink of water?" And the woman is astonished, perhaps even frightened by this word. There is, after all, something comfortable about walls. They may have us in, but at least we don't have to worry about what's on the other side. It's a safe hiding place. And she reacts as you might expect. "Why is it that you, a Jew, ask for water from me, a Samaritan?" But Jesus hears through the words to the woman behind them and takes the conversation to a whole new level with some new and unexpected words. "If you knew the gift of God, you could have asked me. I would have given you living water." That sets her back a little bit. Gets her back up, if you will. Who do you think you are? You haven't even got a bucket. Even Jacob, our greatest ancestor, whose well this is, had to have a bucket to draw water. Are you saying that you are greater than him? And Jesus says, "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. But those who drink of the water I give will never be thirsty again." You can almost see the wheels begin to turn. No more walking down the length of the dusty streets, carrying the heavy jar past the stairs of the neighbors, no more carrying the even heavier full jar of water back home again. "Give me this water that I may never be thirsty," she pleads. And then in the part we didn't read from the gospel this morning, Jesus takes things again to a whole new level. And Jesus says, "All right, go call your husband." And with those words, he takes the conversation to another new level. I have a friend who was a pastor for a long time in his home state of Kentucky. He preached a sermon one Sunday morning in which he casually referenced the dangers of smoking. And on Monday morning, he got a phone call from one of the members of his board of deacons, a tobacco farmer, inviting him out to visit the farm. And my friend went, of course, and while they were walking through the drying sheds, the deacon pointed to one wall filled with large bunches of drying leaves, and he said to them, "See that wall over there, Pastor?" And my friend said, "Yes," and he said, "That's the new church roof." The message was clear. the pastor had crossed a line. As we used to joke in seminary, he had quit preaching and gone to meddling. And right there, Jesus goes to meddling. I have no husband, says the woman. That's right, he says, you have no husband. You've had five husbands, and the one you have now is not yours. Commentators have raised their eyebrows as they looked at this woman. But all of our moral outrage misses Jesus' point, which was that women in Jesus' time simply didn't have a lot of options. She's not devoured husband after husband like some overactive black widow spider. For whatever reason, she's just been passed around from man to man until she no longer even has basic dignity in the eyes of the community. Jesus really isn't accusing her of anything here. He is simply naming one central issue of her life, that she's an outcast among the Samaritans, who were also outcasts. She comes to the well not in the cool of the morning, but in the heat of the day when no one else is supposed to be there. She's not welcomed in polite company, and Jesus, with a single word, has touched on the core issue of her existence. And the fact is that with words, we can sometimes touch the deepest issues of people's lives. Sometimes by speaking, sometimes just by listening. When Jesus raises this issue, she tries to change the subject. I see you are a prophet, she says to him. Let's see, prophets like to talk theology. Isn't it interesting that you Jews worship in Jerusalem on the mountain there? We Samaritans worship on this mountain here. Would you care to comment or clarify the difference between these two theological positions? Or if not, perhaps we can move on to a discussion of realized eschatology. See, you thought I slept through all those classes. But Jesus is not to be distracted. He says, woman, I tell you, the hour is coming and now is when the mountain, the temple, none of it will make any difference. What will make a difference is the way in which we all worship, in spirit and in truth. Me make a difference, she says in essence. Yeah, right. I'll make a difference when the Messiah comes. That's when Jesus says to her the best word of all. I am He. I am the one who is the Word, the living Word, which breaks down walls between human beings. I am the one who is the Word, the living Word, which touches the deepest wounds of our lives. I am the one who is the Word, the living Word, which brings God and human beings together once again. John already said it. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. And Jesus says to her, I am He. Jesus was the Word Himself, the living Word. And because He was and is, this woman had been, who had been an outcast even among her own people, left that place by the well with her own word to speak. She runs into the town telling everyone she meets, come and see the man who told me everything I ever did. Talk about a little hyperbole. I've used that word in two consecutive sermons. There's got to be some points for that. But it was the Word became flesh and dwelling within her, full of grace and truth, that made all the difference. For when she opened her heart, when she received that Word, she could not hold it in. She had to share it. Paul writes to the Philippians, if, like the woman at the well, you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if you have any comfort from His love, if you have any fellowship with the Spirit, if you have any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having that same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of self-ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Words are important. Words can hurt. Words can heal. Words can strengthen and give us courage and hope. And the fact is that whenever we face our fears and anxieties and venture out, like Jesus calls his disciples to do in faith, into the storms of confusion and hurt and pain that so often fill our worlds, when we venture out to share what we have received, to speak a word of compassion, a word of understanding, a word of encouragement, a word of forgiveness, a word of hope, a word filled with life and power and love, then the promise to us is that by the mercy of God, our frail words will become the earthen vessels for those wonderful words of life, that living water that God offers to all of us that's so desperately needed today. We pledge ourselves and our lives to the service of the living Word, and he calls us to share that living Word with our world. Next week, one last word. Let's pray. Oh God, we are grateful for the opportunity that you give to us to speak to our world wonderful words of life, words of hope, words of grace, words of compassion, words of truth. Be with us. Inspire us. Give us your words to share, that others might come to know you. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.